Welcome back to White Paper and Chill. In this episode, we're breaking down hydrangea, optimistic two-round partial synchrony. Now, this is a really fascinating white paper. It introduces a new consensus protocol, basically a new way for blockchains to agree on things, aiming to make them faster and more resilient. So today we're going to explore a few key things. How hydrangea might allow for, well, incredibly fast transaction finality, getting your transactions confirmed quickly under, you know, ideal network conditions. We'll look at its unique ability to handle different kinds of problems simultaneously, both malicious Byzantine faults, where someone's actively trying to cheat, and simple crash faults, where nodes just stop working. We'll also touch on the strong theory behind its performance, like why the paper argues it's almost the best possible approach. And maybe most importantly for you, what could this all mean for the future of crypto, for everyone, from end users to the builders creating these systems? Okay, let's unpack this. So just to set the stage a bit, let's talk about the basic challenge in blockchain. Getting everyone to agree, this is consensus, right? You've got all these computers, nodes spread out everywhere, and they need to agree on the state of things, even if some are offline or worse, actively trying to mess things up.
Right. And what's really fascinating and has been a challenge for ages is this inherent trade-off. You know, historically, these protocols, these ways of agreeing, they could be really fast or they could be super resilient, but getting both, that was tough. Think about the classic BFT protocols, Byzantine fault-tolerant ones like PBFT or Tendermint, which you might have heard of. They're incredibly robust.
Yeah, they can handle a lot going wrong.
Exactly. They can tolerate a good chunk of participants being faulty or malicious.
Yeah.
But the cost is usually speed. To get that rock-solid guarantee, they typically need like three rounds of back and forth communication just to commit a single transaction, even when everything's running perfectly.
Three rounds. And okay, maybe that doesn't sound like a disaster. Mm. When you're talking about scaling a network for, you know, millions of users or high-speed finance.
Every millisecond counts.
Absolutely.
It's not just a minor delay. It could be a fundamental bottleneck for the whole system's throughput.
Right.
And that three round thing, it isn't just some arbitrary number they picked. It's actually a known theoretical lower bound. Yeah, a fundamental limit for protocols that can handle up to, say, one-third of the participants being malicious Byzantine actors and operate in what's called a partially synchronous network.
Partially synchronous, meaning messages might get delayed sometimes, but they don't just disappear forever, like the internet being slow but not completely broken.
Pretty much, yeah. Messages eventually get through. So to get that high level of security in that kind of realistic network setting, people thought you just had to accept that three-round latency.
Okay, so if three rounds was seen as this kind of hard limit for really robust systems, have others tried to push past that, tried to get faster?
Oh, absolutely. That's a really important question because, yeah, there's been a whole line of research trying to tip away at that. Protocols like Kudzu, Fab, SBFT, they've explored what are often called optimistic paths.
Optimistic paths, meaning they hope for the best.
Sort of, yeah. The idea is if the network conditions are good, if, say, fewer nodes are actually faulty than the maximum the system could handle, then maybe you can take a shortcut. And they showed, yes, you can get down to two rounds sometimes. Kudzu, for example, can manage two-round commits if fewer than, like, 20% of the nodes are misbehaving.
Ah, okay, so speed is possible, but it sounds like there's a catch coming. What is it? Where's the trade-off?
Yeah, there usually is one. The catch is often that this speed boost comes at the cost of overall resilience. If more nodes fail than that optimistic threshold,
then things slow down or break.
Performance can drop significantly, yeah. Or their ability to tolerate the full range of faults they're designed for might weaken in those faster modes. It becomes a bit fragile. And we've seen some ambitious claims out there too, like Solana's Alpenglow was talked about aiming for two rounds while handling high percentages of both Byzantine and crash faults, maybe 20% of each.
Wow, 40% total. That sounds like really pushing it.
It's definitely pushing the boundaries of what was thought possible, especially within those known theoretical limits.
So with all these attempts hitting walls or making compromises, this is where hydrangea steps in. How does it claim to do better?
Exactly. This is where the hydrangea white paper comes in, proposing a way to, well, hopefully, get the best of both worlds. To bridge that gap we were talking about, fundamentally, hydrangea is described as a partially synchronous Byzantine fault-tolerant state machine replication protocol. That's a mouthful, I know.
Huh. Yeah, just a bit. Break it down.
Basically, it's a system designed for agreement in potentially slow networks, partially synchronous, that can handle cheaters, Byzantine faults, and also nodes just crashing to keep a consistent record, state machine replication. its main goal. Achieve that fast, optimistic two-round commit when things are going well. But crucially, without sacrificing the ability to handle a lot of faults when things get rough. And it specifically looks at handling both Byzantine and crash faults together.
Okay, handling both types sounds complex. How does it define how many faults it can actually take? You mentioned some parameters earlier.
Right. The white paper uses this formula. N equals 3F plus 2C plus K plus 1.
Okay. N is the total number of notes.
Yep. Total participants.
Mm-hmm.
F is the maximum number of those really nasty, malicious Byzantine faults it can handle.
The cheaters. Yeah.
C is the maximum number of simple crash faults nodes that just go offline.
Okay.
And K is interesting. It's like a tuning knob. It lets you adjust the balance a bit between performance and how many crash faults you can tolerate relative to Byzantine ones.
A flexibility parameter. Got it. So using this setup, how does it actually hit that two-round target? What are the optimistic conditions it needs?
So the paper defines this threshold, P, which is calculated as C plus K by 2. Basically, it depends on the number of crash faults, C, and that tuning knob.
Yeah. Okay.
If the total number of actual faults happening right now, adding up both the Byzantine ones and the crashed ones, is less than or equal to this P value,
Then boom, two rounds.
That's the fast path. But, and this is key, if things get worse, if the number of faults exceeds P, but still stays within the overall limits of F Byzantine and C crash faults.
It doesn't just fall over.
No, exactly. It gracefully falls back to a three-round commit. So it still maintains that high level of resilience, matching the guarantees of the classic robust protocols. You have speed when possible, but safety always.
That really does sound like a significant step. Speed without sacrificing the safety net. So how? What's the magic? Can you give us a simplified view of how it works differently to get that fast path? Why do others need three rounds?
Okay, let's try to simplify it. Think about why you typically need those extra rounds in standard protocols. It often boils down to guaranteeing two things, safety and liveness.
Safety meaning everyone agrees on the same thing, no contradictions. Liveness meaning the system keeps moving forward, it doesn't just get stuck.
Exactly. If you try to commit too quickly, say after just one round of voting, there's a risk. Imagine one group of nodes sees enough votes to commit block A, but because of network delays, another group doesn't see those votes yet. If the leader fails, the second group might end up committing a different block B later. That's a safety violation, two different histories. Big problem.
Right, total chaos for a blockchain. So how does Hydrangea avoid that in its two-round path?
It uses a couple of clever observations, according to the white paper. First, it gets smarter about view changes. That's when the network has to switch to a new leader because the old one is suspected to be faulty or slow.
Okay.
Instead of just looking at which blocks nodes might have locked onto, Hydrangea also pays close attention to who actually voted for recent blocks. It uses more granular information from the voting process itself.
So it's like looking at the ballot papers, not just the final result.
That's a decent analogy, yeah.
Yeah.
It gives the new leader a much richer picture of what the honest nodes were actually thinking and supporting, even if the previous leader was trying to cause trouble or messages were delayed. Helps prevent picking a conflicting block.
Okay, that makes sense. More information, better decisions. What's the second part?
The second part relates back to that fault model. Mm-hmm. N equals 3F plus 2C plus K plus 1. By explicitly designing for this mix of Byzantine and crash faults, it enables something powerful with what are called quorums.
Quorums, like the minimum number of votes needed to agree.
Exactly. To commit quickly in two rounds, Hydrangea needs a specific quorum size to vote for a block. The math behind this specific fault model ensures something called quorum intersection.
Okay, quorum intersection. Sounds technical, layman's terms.
Think of it like this. Even if two different groups of nodes, two quorums, vote at slightly different times, maybe because of network delays or a leader change, the rules guarantee that these two groups must overlap. They must share a certain number of honest members.
Ah, so there's always some common ground between any two groups that reach agreement.
Precisely. And because of that guaranteed overlap of honest nodes, it ensures that if one quorum committed block A, any subsequent quorum has to see evidence of that commitment via those overlapping honest nodes. They can't just ignore it and commit a conflicting block B. It forces consistency, ensuring safety, even in just two rounds under those optimistic conditions.
That's clever. It uses the structure of the fault tolerance itself to guarantee consistency faster. Okay, this brings us to the big questions for anyone listening. Do we actually need this? I mean, how will this really improve crypto for regular people, for you?
Oh, I think we absolutely need this. Look, bridging that gap between latency, how long you wait, and fault tolerance, how reliable it is huge. For end users, for the retail community, for you interacting with crypto day to day, it means faster transaction finality.
Less waiting.
Way less waiting. Remember that feeling when you send some crypto or buy an NFT or interact with a DeFi app and you're just staring at that pending status?
Yeah, hitting refresh frantically.
Exactly. Hydrangea aims to make that experience much smoother, much quicker, more reliable confirmations, fewer delays. It just makes using crypto feel less clunky and more like the seamless digital experiences we expect elsewhere.
Okay, that's the user side. What about the people building this stuff? The builders and developers, what's in it for them?
For builders, it provides a foundation that's both faster and more robust in handling real-world network weirdness. They can design applications, dApps, with stronger guarantees about consistency and speed. Imagine trying to build, say, a really fast-paced on-chain game or a high-frequency trading system on a blockchain. You need both speed and certainty. Hydrangea gives developers a stronger base layer to work with.
So it could enable new kinds of applications that maybe weren't practical before because the underlying consensus was too slow or couldn't reliably handle network issues?
Potentially, yes. It simplifies things for them because the consensus layer itself is more capable. It raises the bar for what BFT consensus can do, making the whole ecosystem potentially more performant and trustworthy.
Now, you mentioned earlier that the white paper doesn't just say Hydrangea is good, it provides some heavy-duty theory, a lower bound proof. What's the significance of that? Does it mean this is the best we can ever do?
That lower bound is really important, actually. It's a theoretical proof within the paper that basically says, under these specific assumptions about partially synchronous networks and this mix of faults, no protocol can achieve a two-round commit if the number of faults exceeds C plus K plus 2 by 2.
So it defines the absolute limit.
It defines a hard limit, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And Hydrangea, by reaching two rounds when faults are at or below C plus K by 2, gets incredibly close to that theoretical limit. It's not just a clever design, it's provably near optimal for its specific goals and assumptions.
And that has implications for other protocols too, right? Like the Alpenglow example you mentioned.
Exactly. That lower bound provides a yardstick. If Hydrangea's proof holds, it suggests that claims of achieving two rounds with significantly higher fault combinations, like 20% Byzantine and 20% crash simultaneously while committing in two rounds, with 20% faults, which is way above Hydrangea's P threshold for two rounds, might be violating these fundamental limits, at least within this standard partially synchronous model. It adds a lot of weight and credibility to Hydrangea's approach.
Theory is great, proofs are great, but did they actually, you know, build it and test it? Is there real-world validation?
Yes, and that's crucial. The white paper includes details of a pretty thorough evaluation. They didn't just simulate it, they deployed it on Google Cloud Platform.
Okay.
They set up 100 nodes spread across 10 different global regions, so a realistic distributed environment. They then compared Hydrangea directly against their existing protocol called Moonshot.
How do they configure Hydrangea for the tests?
They set it up to tolerate 20% Byzantine faults and 20% crash faults, which, importantly, represents a more challenging mix of faults than Moonshot's baseline tolerance of just 33% Byzantine faults.
So, aiming for tougher conditions, and the results?
The results showed Hydrangea consistently achieved about 20% lower latency. It was faster across different block sizes compared to Moonshot.
Faster while tolerating that more complex fault mix.
Exactly. Faster and arguably more robust in the types of faults it could handle simultaneously.
Mm.
So it wasn't just theoretical speed. It showed practical performance benefits in a real-world-like setup.
Okay, so wrapping this up, what's the big picture here? It feels like Hydrangea isn't just, you know, another minor tweak to consensus.
I think that's right. It represents a potentially significant step towards blockchain systems that are genuinely both fast and highly resilient. It tackles that core trade-off head-on.
Which, going back to what you said, could mean higher throughput for networks, stronger consistency guarantees.
Right. Leading to a better experience for users, less waiting, more reliability. And for developers, a more powerful platform to build on, potentially enabling applications that need that combination of speed and robustness. It helps mature the underlying technology of blockchains.
So it really pushes things forward, which leads to a final thought, maybe something for you, our listener, to chew on. As protocols like Hydrangea keep advancing, breaking down these old barriers between speed and security, what entirely new things might become possible? What kinds of decentralized applications or use cases, things we can barely even imagine today, could emerge when the underlying infrastructure becomes this fast and this trustworthy? Something to think about. And that concludes our deep dive into the Hydrangea white paper. Thank you for joining us on White Paper and Chill.